Thank you for joining me once again in our continual study of the commandments. For those of you who are just now following me, please don't start here. Please go to the very beginning, law number one. The purpose of the study is to familiarize ourselves with the commandments. If you skip ahead, you're not doing so. When we read the Bible, we want to start at page one. So by the time you get to the New Testament, you understand the Old. Christianity is out of order today because it fails to respect the Old Testament. And by respect, I mean understand. Respecting the word means to know it from beginning to end, to know what it's saying. Respecting the Most High means to understand what he has commanded. Remembering a bunch of scriptures from the book of Matthew, Romans, and John is not the same as knowing the word. If you've been following along from the start of the study, welcome back and thank you. I really appreciate you. We left off going through laws about sacrificial offerings, but there are additional laws pertaining to offerings as well. But first, I want to remind you, especially Christians out there, that one thing you need to understand is the term offerings that you hear in today's churches differs from what it actually meant in the biblical days. Offerings were brought on behalf of a spiritual cause to honor the Most High, not to pay the bills of a pastor. Today, pastors see offerings as extra money to support them financially, that you should gladly bring to them because they deserve it. In the biblical days, it was viewed as a sacrifice made by the Israelites to bring them closer to the Most High, an effort of submission to bring their faulty ways back in line with Him, or a form of repentance. And although the priest did consume some of the animal offerings brought to the temple, they were the priest doing so. Offerings being brought to a preacher is not the same as the offerings that were brought to the priest at the temple. It's not the same. I try to stress that many of the Old Testament scriptures can't be used today for our own purpose. They meant what they meant then, and they can't be replicated today and mean the same as they meant back then. In other words, your pastor is not the priest. His or her church is not the temple. So don't allow them to use scripture to turn themselves into a priest who is worthy of your tithe and your heave offering or your sin offering or any other offering. If you desire to support someone in ministry, a gift is one thing, or a gift offering, or whatever you want to call it, but the offerings from the Old Testament cannot be done today. They say because the Messiah came as the Most High sacrifice, animal sacrifices are no longer needed for the atonement of sin. But there's another fundamental reason why animal sacrifices no longer stand. None of the offerings done in the biblical days can be done today. That's why these laws are marked with three asterisks. Outside of the temple, outside of the land, these sacrificial laws cannot be kept. The Messiah himself will tell you that because he taught the law. The law specifically says in Deuteronomy 12:11, all offerings are to be done in the temple. So outside of the temple, it cannot be done. Now, I teach that what the Messiah's death did do is usher in the promise of Jeremiah 31:31, the promise of grace and mercy as we attempt to keep the commandments. And now that mercy takes the place of the punishment and the judgment we once endured, death that was due to us, now mercy and grace stand in the place of judgment and punishment. No, grace does not replace obedience. Grace does not replace the law. This is what Christianity teaches. But it replaces the judgment portion of the law for those who fall short of keeping it. So animal sacrifices are not done, number one, because there is no temple to do them in, and number two, because the death of the Messiah ushers in the grace and mercy that animal sacrifices once were performed for. We're relearning what Christianity has taught us with Old Testament knowledge. That being said, these laws too will have three asterisks because they can no longer be kept today. They're valid laws but cannot be honored outside of the temple today. So again, I will go through them rather quickly. We're looking at how the tabernacle or the temple was taken care of daily by the Levites. Remember the Levitical tithe I was talking about that was given to the Levites as a salary for the work they did in the temple. So let's look at some of the work that they were commanded to do. But first, the command given to the children of Israel in law number 373 to offer two lambs every day. One lamb was offered in the morning and one in the evening. This was considered a continual burnt offering. Looking at duties of the Levites, Aaron and his sons, law number 374 to light a fire on the altar every day, Leviticus 6:6. Law 375, not to extinguish this fire. Leviticus 6:6. For both of these laws, when you read Leviticus 6:6, you won't find these commands. But when you go down to verse 13, we find it says, the fire shall ever be burning upon the altar. It shall never go out. So the scriptural reference for both of these should be changed to verse 13. That's the reason for the two asterisks. The reference needs to be changed. And again, three asterisks there means these laws can no longer be kept today. Looking at law number 376, to remove the ashes from the altar every day. Another duty of the Levites. This command is actually found in verse 10. And it reads, and the priest shall put on his linen garment and breeches and take up the ashes which the fire has consumed with the offering. So this one needs to be changed also to verse 10. Law number 377, to burn incense every day. Exodus 30 verse 7. Law 378, to light the menorah every day. Exodus 27 verse 21. Law number 379, the Kohen Gadol must bring a meal offering every day. Leviticus 6 verse 13. This reference is actually found in verse 15, so it needs to be changed. A Kohen Gadol is the high priest, the very first being Aaron, brother of Moses. Law 380, to bring two additional lambs as burnt offerings on Shabbat. Numbers 28 9. Law 381, to make the showbread. Exodus 25 30. 382, to bring additional offerings on the new month. Numbers 28 11. We're looking at the additional offerings brought for the holy days. Law 383, to bring additional offerings on Passover. Numbers 28 19. 384, to offer the wave offering from the meal of the new wheat. Leviticus 23 10. Law 385, each man must count the Omer, 7 weeks from the day the new wheat offering was brought. Leviticus 23, verse 15. Law 386, to bring additional offerings on Feast of Weeks. Numbers 28, 26. 387, to bring two leaves to accompany the above sacrifice. Leviticus 23, verse 17. Law 388, to bring additional offerings on Rosh Hashanah, Feast of Trumpets. Numbers 29 verse 2. Law 389, to bring additional offerings on Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement. Numbers 29 verse 8. Law 390, to bring additional offerings on Sukkot, Tabernacles. Numbers 29 13. Law number 391, to bring additional offerings on Shemini Atzeret, the eighth day after Tabernacles. Numbers 29 35. Now we're going to look at disqualified offerings, animals no longer fit to be offerings or sacrifices. Looking at law number 392, not to eat sacrifices which have become unfit or blemished. Deuteronomy 14 verse 3. So they could not eat disqualified sacrifices. Law number 393, not to eat sacrifices offered with improper intentions, Leviticus 7:18. So not only is the animal itself examined for disqualification, the intent behind bringing the animal must be honest, like in law number 342, which prohibited a Jew from having a non-Jew bring a blemished offering, trying to trick the system, so to speak, fool the Most High. So offerings are disqualified because the intent is not right, it's dishonest. Law 394, not to leave sacrifices past the time allowed for eating them, Leviticus 22:30. 395, not to eat from what is left over, Leviticus 19:8. Law number 396, not to eat from sacrifices which became impure, Leviticus 7:19. Law 397, an impure person must not eat from sacrifices, Leviticus 7:20. 398, to burn the leftover sacrifices, Leviticus 7:17, and 399, to burn all impure sacrifices, Leviticus 7:19. So now looking at law number 400, to follow the procedure of Yom Kippur in the sequence prescribed in Parshat Akarei Mot, Leviticus 16, verse 3. Parshat Akarei Mot means after the death. That is the death of the two sons of Aaron that were killed when they offered strange fire on the altar. They had decided to offer their own sacrifice in their own way on the altar, and the Most High killed them for that. You can read about it in Leviticus 16. Subsequently, the Most High instructed them to make certain they enter the temple only in a prescribed manner during the time of atonement. And the final laws in this section, which pertain to misuse of sanctified property, law number 401, one who profaned property must repay what he profaned, plus a fifth, and bring a sacrifice, Leviticus 5:16. Law 402, not to work consecrated animals, Deuteronomy 15:19. And law 403, not to shear the fleece of consecrated animals, Deuteronomy 15:19. So there are a lot of sacrificial laws, as you guys can see. When the Israelites went to church, it was strictly business. They took it very seriously. They followed specific laws and were obedient to what was commanded. They weren't making it up like we do in today's churches. Dress up nice and pretty, park in our reserved parking spaces, sit in our reserved seats, dance and sing, put money in the tray. The choir blesses us with a song, put more money in the tray. The preacher yells at us for 20, 30 minutes. We put more money in the tray. Then we go to the altar, say a prayer, and go home. No Torah study, no mention of the commandments. That system, that church system, was not ordained or designed in the Bible. Lots of talk about repentance, but with no knowledge of a law to repent from, the entire congregation is completely confused on what they are to repent from. And of course, you're not allowed to raise your hand and ask, so you walk out confused. And we do this week after week, month after month, year after year, for years. Zombies caught up in somebody's church. So we need to rethink what church really is, what our commanded assembly should really be about, because assembling for foolishness is assembly in vain. I'm not trying to waste my time assembling if the true word is not being taught. And for those of you out there who need confirmation, I'm telling you now, it's not the will of the Most High to assemble in a place with a people who care not about the laws of the Most High. You're better off going to some underground satanic worship service. They don't care about the laws of the Most High either. The difference is the Christian church looks the part. You walk in, it looks holy, but it cares nothing about holy things. At least the satanic church is true to itself, not pretending to be something it's not. And yes, I'm comparing the church of witchcraft with the Christian church because I want you to see that pretending to be about the Most High's business when you're not is no better than those who care not about the things of the Most High. It's no better. $1 million building, $1,000 suit, 10,000 member congregation means nothing. You look good, you look the part, but you are not. Christianity is a well-dressed $1 billion religion that cares not about the things of the Most High. We're concluding today, having reviewed 403 laws, 18 laws of which need to be omitted because they were falsely added or repeated by Judaism, 37 laws where the scriptural reference needed to be changed to match where the actual law is found in the Bible, and 174 laws that can no longer be kept today. Again, I'm so grateful for your continual support and prayers. Until next time, this is Judiah. Shalom.